Okay, we're going to have a word of prayer. This is a very important lesson. One of the most important ones we've had. So, Father, we thank you as you lead and direct all that we say, all that we do. Father, we do all in the name of Jesus, and we do it all for your glory. Father, we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we just want to say that our prayer is short because we have a good prayer for 5 or 7. I want you to get hungry enough to come. Now, if the brothers don't show up, we're going to have a different shift for them maybe in the evening, every day in the evening time. We'll get together on that, brothers, because we don't want the women to leave us behind. The women really get annoyed.
Amen.
I know Sister Hope has been here twice this week before. She's been praying. All right. I just wanted you to look through this so you can see what you have at your disposal here. The introduction, let's just look at the subtopics. Your success in the kingdom of God depends largely on your ability to believe. Got some really good points that we've made concerning how important it is for us to work on our ability to believe, because how we think and make decisions is based on how we believe and how we see ourselves. It's really amazing that many times we see ourselves as inferior, as weak, as not a, inability. We see ourselves, not capable of being what God has called us to be. So the believing part is a very important part of our walk with the Lord, because our believing originally is messed up. I don't know whether y'all realize that. There's a lot of components that contributed to the way we believe, and we'll find out about that. We mentioned about there are 4 things that contributes to the way we believe. And anybody can remember those?
Our environment.
Okay.
Critical others.
Okay.
Teachers.
Okay.
Let me see.
Okay.
Life
experience.
Oh, yeah, life experience.
Okay, so what do we mean by environment?
Your surroundings.
How you grow up, what you heard coming out of folks' mouth, mm-hmm. The atmosphere, the environment that you were around when you grew up. And most times we've heard a whole lot of stuff that have damaged us, mm-hmm. and have caused us to be less than what God wants us to be. Everybody agree?
Mm-hmm.
Then, credible authority figures have contributed largely to how we believe, because we've taken them at their word, and most of them didn't even know the word, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they taught us a whole lot of stuff that weren't really true. And they said a lot of things when we were young that damaged us. Boy, you'll never amount to nothing. What else they say? You're just like the old sorry so-and-so. We heard all kind of stuff. Anybody ever heard anything like that coming out of your house?
Yeah.
And that stuff really has some impact on you, whether you believe it or not. So we're dealing with things that were handed down and passed on to us, not only from our parents and grandparents and relatives and friends, but even sometime our teachers and ministers. He came up in a church where they said that I sin, you sin, everybody sin. Man is prone to sin. As the sparks fly up, then you're going to what? You're going to come up believing that what? You can't live a life free and separated from sin. That's the reason why many church people say you can't live without sinning every day. Okay, so they grew up in an environment where that was taught, that was promoted. And sometimes we've heard about sickness, that it's God, if it was God's will, he'll heal you, but if it's not God's will, you know, you won't be healed. And so, you know, we came up believing a whole lot of negative things and things that were not scriptural. So therefore, it has walked out of believing and out of thinking, and we have inferior. We come into the kingdom of God with what an inferior mindset. Okay, let's go on to be believing with your heart is the only way you can receive from God except through the manifestations of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Anybody want to challenge that? The only way you can receive from God is except through believing with your heart. So if you're going to believe a Bible way, you're going to have to believe with your heart. Okay, anybody can give us an idea what it means to believe with your heart? Believe with your heart. Believe with your heart.
That the answer in number one underneath there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what does it say?
The God kind of faith is based on believing the word of God from your heart, not your head, and confessing with your mouth God's word which you believe in your heart.
Mm-hmm. Okay, believing from your heart is what? It's when you speak the word of God, and that word is really what? A live word. You know, every time you speak something from your heart, it's not a living word. It's not a rhema word. And that's the kind of word that Jesus spoke whenever he spoke to the fig tree. What did Jesus say to the fig tree in Mark 11? He spoke to that fig tree and said what?
Cursed.
And he said what?
That it wouldn't
matter. Yeah, nobody will what? Nobody will eat from this tree no more. From this point on, nobody's going to eat from this tree. And immediately, the power of God was ministered to the root of that tree. And that tree began to what? Die. And in 3 days they came back. The thing was what? It was withered. Okay, so that at that point, the power of God is released and begins to work. So when you believe from your heart, Jesus said, the words that I speak are what? Spirit, and they are what? Life. So when you feed on the word until you begin to get impregnated with the word, until that word becomes what? A living thing. Then it has power to what? To do whatever it's designed to do. But sometimes it takes a while before you can come to the point where the word is what? Alive. And you know, just like sometimes people hear the teachings on healing, and they understand that Christ bore your sicknesses and what? Carry your diseases. And then they begin to what? Release their faith for healing, but the healing doesn't always come right away, right? They would have to what? Continue to what? Agree with the word, okay, Christ, you bore my sickness, you carried my diseases. Sometimes they would have to what? Feed their heart faith. In other words, that word has to come out of their mouth until that word really gets what? Rooted and established in your heart. Okay, now I want to say that again. Sometimes when you first begin to speak the word, it's not going to have the effect that you expect it to have. Because it doesn't have enough what? Life in it. It's not really in your heart. Can y'all agree? Okay, now, Sister Hill always gives her famous illustrations of when she was an actor. And when she first began to quote those lines for those plays, y'all understand? That those words didn't have the life. You didn't have the feeling. I mean, she wasn't emotionally involved in it until she got to a certain point. Is that right? So God uses, has to work through, I think on the next page, I'm not jumping over there yet, but I thought I had, it said, we must understand, see, that God works within the framework of how he has designed us to expand our capability to believe. In other words, he must work through our mind, he must work through our what? Will, imagination, emotions, and intellect. See, God has to work through all of those areas before the Word of God is going to come into fruition. So your mind got to be involved, you understand? Your will, you got to make what? A decision to what?
Second.
Right, to believe, to hang in there until the Word becomes reality. Imagination, you got to what? See the end results of whatever you're what? Believing for?
You got to see it before you can see it.
Right, you got to see it before you can see it. And then you got to feel it. You got to feel it. See, the emotional part of this is more or less, what part of would involve your emotions? After you see something, then you begin to get excited about it. And you begin to what? Get emotionally involved. And that's praise. Praise. Praise and worship. Amen. So, see, all of that is the process of really bringing to pass the Word of God. In other words, believing from your heart is really a process. Amen. So it's not just reading something two or three times, and then you say, well, I believe, and you expect it to happen, and your faith hasn't really become what alive. You haven't worked with the Word enough in order for that Word to become alive in your heart. Because sometimes people have to confess by His stripes I'm healed for 6 months. And all of a sudden, they realize, I don't have that problem anymore. When did it leave? When your faith came into what? Fruition, when it was established, when it became alive. In other words, when it became a rhema word to you. So sometimes you have to feed your heart faith. Well, your mouth has to feed your heart faith. And the initial stages of that, you're not going to see any manifestations or any change in your conditions. Because the initial stage of confession is actually changing the way you see yourself on the inside. In other words, it's changing the inside of you. So don't get discouraged when you confess the Word and nothing happens to you outwardly. You know, if the money, the $500 doesn't come in tomorrow, some people say, well, my faith is not working. Okay, but the initial process of faith is not going to be what you expect, because it's working on the inside before it starts working on the what? Outside. Okay, now I have some, I'm just going to kind of jump around because there's some points I want to make. Okay, this is on page 14. Under 5A, which is verbalization, releasing words. Let's look at number 4, under A. The first stage of the meditation process, which is speaking forth the Word of God to get it into your heart. Amen. That's the first stage of meditation, is when you begin to speak forth the Word of God to get it into your heart. Okay, that does very little to effect change. See, that's the reason why we stress releasing words all the time. Every opportunity I get when I pray, I like to release words, because words are very powerful. They work for you. Amen. And I don't care how much you think about the Word, if you don't release it, it's just like having seeds in a bag, amen, and not what? Planting them in the soil. It's not going to what? Bring forth the crop that you expect. And the same thing with a thought. If a thought just stops with a thought in your mind, those thoughts are going to die in your mind unborn. It takes words released in order to release the power of God and to get things working on your behalf. So that's the reason why we said speaking forth the Word of God to get it into your heart. I'd like to think about when all of us first learned our timetables. And we just, we started with the what? Ones and the twos and the threes. We said them over and 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 over, right?
Mm-hmm.
In other words, to get them into our subconscious mind, to get them into our heart, we can just say. And see, when they got into our heart, then what? You didn't even have to think about when someone said, which 9 times 7? Mm-hmm. 6 to 3. No conscious effort at all was exerted to recall what 12 times 9 or 12 times 8 was. No conscious effort, because you had programmed it into your heart, into your subconscious mind. So when the word gets to the point where you begin to act spontaneously without even thinking about it, without even consciously thinking about what you're doing, it just happens automatically. That's when the Word of God really becomes alive into your heart. So we want to focus on that. We're lessons to heal, acting is very much like that, because when you start practicing a part, I don't know any actor really feel that comfortable in the initial stages doing those lines. They don't feel like that character that they're trying to what? Project. Okay, so what we see here, he's going to talk about that in a minute. Speaking forth the word of God to get into your heart does very little to affect change initially in your circumstances. All right, it is affecting change in you, all right, but it's changing you on the what? Inside. It's deprogramming you and painting a new picture of you, what? Inwardly. Okay, now why does the word have to work inside before you can see it work on the outside? Because what? Why does the word have to work inside of you before you can see it work on the outside?
My heart hasn't changed, but you see it differently before it can be expressed in your life.
All right. Everybody else, that's good.
Like the seed, it has to be planted.
All right, seed has to be planted. Now, when the children of Israel went over, those 12 spies went over, okay, y'all can talk from that. When those 12 spies went over, okay, 12 of them, how many came back with a good report?
Two.
Who were they?
Joshua.
All right, what the 10 evil spies say? What were their conclusion when they viewed everything, spied out the land? What was their conclusion?
Can't do it.
Okay, now how did they see themselves?
Grasshoppers.
As inferior. Right? Substandard. Not capable. Too little. Too weak. They're not able. Then how did Caleb and Joshua see themselves?
They said
we're well able.
Well able.
And guess who eventually made it to the promised land? Guess who eventually made it to the promised land? Caleb and who?
Joshua.
They were the only two that started out initially. Everybody else died in the wilderness, because they said that you brought us out in this wilderness, what? For all of us to die without children. So all of them died, and the word that they spoke actually what? Came to pass, except for those that were 20 and below.
Now, with the 10 spies, mm-hmm. what they saw mm-hmm. was actually what was there.
Yes, they did, right?
And, they didn't relate anything that wasn't true.
They
were looking
right.
at the circumstances, mm-hmm. but they were not looking at what the Word of God said.
Mm-hmm.
But Caleb and Joshua was looking at the, they saw the circumstances as well,
mm-hmm.
but they were looking at what the Word of God said. That's the difference.
Mm-hmm.
And because when they looked at the Word of God mm-hmm. and said, we can do it,
mm-hmm.
then you open the avenue for it to happen. Mm-hmm. When you have that Word programmed in your, and you believe that you can, the circumstances don't disappear, they're still there.
Mm-hmm.
But you believe that mm-hmm. you can surmount the circumstances.
Right. Mm-hmm. Scripture says if we observe blind vanities, if God says one thing and the circumstances says what? Something altogether different, mm-hmm.
Now, who's alive?
Circumstances.
All right. So, if the circumstances say you can't, and God says you can, now who you side with?
God.
If you observe, we call the circumstances when God said you can, we call them what? Lying, you're lying. Lying vanities. The Bible says if we observe lying vanities, we forsake God's mercy.
But if the word of God is not really programmed in your spirit, when those circumstances come, you're going to look at those circumstances.
And you're going to be governed by it.
The word of God is not.
Okay, everybody agree with that? Mm-hmm. Okay, now what was so different about Caleb and Joshua that they had altered, they saw themselves altogether different than the other 10 spies? What do y'all think maybe positioned them to be, to have a better view of themselves on the inside? What do you think they did that the 10 didn't do?
Well, they meditated God's word. They did the thing you're telling us we need to do.
I think they was more a little bit more military orientated because they knew the battle, it was going to take a fight for them to win it. Mm-hmm. So they were more willing to believe God that they could overcome them through a battle.
Right.
So militarily wise, I think they knew something a little bit more than what the other 10 knew. Right. They were more braver.
Joshua had been with Moses, right?
Right.
And whenever Moses went up to the mountain to pray, Joshua was somewhere, what, close around. He was a military commander,
right,
too, as well. And Joshua heard this from God. To, he said, as I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. Isn't that amazing? And that was a part of his, what, thinking. And that's the way that he saw himself. He was just like God was with Moses. I don't care what came against Moses. Moses what? He came out what? Victoriously. So he knew that God would be with him just like he was what? With Moses. And so there are some components that we have to admit that really impact our believing and really elevates our believing. To a level where we can actually see the Word of God really, you know, fulfill in our lives. And one of those things would be, I like prayer. Somebody said that a person on their knees can see more than a person standing up tiptoeing. See, whatever the mind can conceive and believe, if you can't see it before you see it, you'll never see it. That's what Sister Hill was saying. But how do you see things? How can you see the end results of things that God has promised you before they even take place? You can see it, what, through meditation? Through what?
Through
meditation, through the word, visions. You know, every time in the Old Testament, if y'all read this entire thing, you'll get a lot of information. But it mentions about when God called men like Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and those great men, most of them felt incapable of carrying out the mission that God had called them to do. They felt totally incapable. And God had to do something to elevate their belief before God could actually get involved with them. See, God can only get involved with us until our belief comes up to a certain level. We got to really work on that so God can get involved in our lives. So God gave all of these men some type of vision or dream. And I like to think of, y'all know about Daniel. How could Daniel be so focused and so established in God, going through all of the adversities and problems and trials? You know, most people would have given up during the process of him going from the pit to the, what, pool, from the
My father said, to the poor pit. From the pit to the highest position in Egypt. Most people would have given up, being in prison.
You're talking about Daniel or Joseph?
I'm talking about Joseph, right. Mm-hmm. So you can see that, but Joseph had a dream. And in that dream, he saw himself what? Reigning over his what? His family. Right. And in the vision that God gave him, the interpretation of the dream that Pharaoh had, he was given even a clear picture of what God was eventually going to do in that particular. And I believe he had an inkling that he was the person that God had raised up to bring deliverance and salvation to that nation all alone, because God has shown him in a vision. So God has to use visions and dreams to elevate our belief to a point so he can work and bring to pass the things that he has designed to do through us. Visions and dreams can actually do it. Ezekiel saw himself preaching to a valley of dry bones. That gave him courage to rise up and to what? To speak to Israel and to prophesy to those bones and what caused those bones to what? To live. But he saw the vision. And most times today, we don't have a whole lot of visions. And sometimes people say, well, if I had a vision of Jesus, if Jesus appeared to me, I would really have strong faith. If Jesus would just come in my room, man, my faith, man, that's all I would need.
Mm-hmm. That's true. I think it's true. If you have an encounter,
right,
that could happen.
in this, you'll find out that the experience is going to have, there's environment. Sister Hill mentioned there are there's authority figures that have shaped our beliefs. And repetitions, information that we've heard all of our life, that has a lot to do with how we believe. But the area that has most impact on our believing is life experiences. What you actually what? Experience naturally, soulish, or spiritually. That's the way God has designed to get our belief at a level where he can actually get involved in carrying out the word that he has established for our lives. Okay, so I'm just kind of skimming over this, but back to page 14, if you haven't turned, the first stage of the meditation process, which is speaking forth the word of God to get it into your heart, does very little to affect change initially in your circumstances. It is affecting change in you. Is changing you on the inside, deprogramming you, and painting a new picture of who? You inwardly. And God knows most of us, we suffer from a self-image problem. And that's the thing that really hinders our faith, because we see ourselves as incapable of what? Of receiving those things that God has what? Clearly pointed. God says a whole lot of things about who we are in Him. And then down on the inside, we said, no, that couldn't be me. I've gone through this, I've gone through that. I don't believe that God would do that, for me, because just look at what I'm all about. And so that is the reason why the speaking forth the word of God to get it into your heart is so important. Because it paints a new picture. If we all understood the importance of a new picture being painted on the inside of us so that we can get out of our old inferior complex type zone, we can get out of that. If we could release all that negative information some kind of way and really begin to see ourselves as God sees us, well, we'll be a powerful force in the kingdom of God. Amen. So I'm not telling y'all to meditate just to keep y'all busy. Pastor, he just wants us busy all the time. I want to watch TV. I want to have fun. But it's for your own good. Y'all believe that? It's for your own good.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Now, it's watch this. It's educating your spirit and bringing it into harmony with the Word of God. It's reprogramming you and renewing your mind. I like that. All right. The number five is the stage in which the Word is impregnating or infusing your spirit with life and energy. And number six, the key to partaking of the life and energy in the Word is feeding on it until it penetrates your spirit, where it deposits that life and energy. Okay, now let me just give you an illustration. Like this morning we were in prayer, and you know, for the first 30 minutes, y'all know how prayer is the first 20, 30 minutes. How is it the first 20 or 30 minutes? Slow pace. All right. Then after about 30, 45 minutes, it seemed like the anointing begins to what? Rise a little bit, right? Okay, now, most times people be, what, meditating. They'll be speaking the Word. And I think it's very important for us to understand that something needs to be released. Something needs to be released. Even if you're praying in the Spirit, those are words being what? Released in the supernatural realm. And so you can release words, and you know, by praying in the Spirit, you can release words by what? Speaking forth the Word of God. You know, it can be in praise, or it can be in, you know, just speaking forth the Word. But what happens is that as you begin to do that, and I strongly suggest that if you don't have a pretty good handle on the Word of God, if you think you can't remember enough to say while you're praying, then you can just, you know, turn to your meditation book or material and just speak scriptures out aloud. You'd be surprised at how that builds up your spirit. And it actually, as this point says, is that feeding on it until it penetrates your spirit, where it deposits that life and energy. Have you noticed that after you feed on the Word for a while, after you pray the Spirit for a while, after you praise and worship for a while, when you get real happy, you just feel real happy on the inside, real joy. Amen. Sometimes you feel like just hollering out loud or running around or jumping. Well, nobody else feel like that? Okay, so I think that at that point, when your spirit gets impregnated with the Word of God and it becomes alive, I think that's the best time to release your faith for whatever promise you are believing for. Because at that point, Jesus said, the words that I speak are spirit and light. When the words become spirit and light, you know, sometimes when we first start praying, you know, you're kind of dead, your mind and spirit and what? Your mind and your body and your spirit are not all what? Hooked up, right? And that might not be the best time for you to what? Make your petitions. Okay, but how you hook up your spirit, mind, and soul together so life can begin to what? Emerge from your spirit. And that, I believe, is the point where you begin to believe from your heart. Amen. Believing from your heart is the point, I think, that when your spirit is impregnated, saturated with the what? Word, until it just what? Becomes rhema. It becomes alive. Amen. So it's important for you to pray through. It's important until you break through in prayer. So let's go back to them. I just wanted to bring that point out so that you can understand that. Sister Hill, maybe you can just, because I think acting out the Word, acting on the Word, is very similar to a person acting in a play. You want to just kind of share how that works out?
Acting on the Word is similar to acting in a play? Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. Okay. When you go in, I'm just recalling when I was in college and You go in and you cast for the part. You read it first. And when you read over it, it doesn't mean that much to you. You're just reading what's on the printed page. And if you're selected for that part, then you begin to study. You begin to read it and read it and read it and read it until you get a better feel for it. And once you get a feel for it, then the focus is on meditating on it. And you learn it by memory, rote, if you will. And once you do that, you still don't really have it. You have it up here. You memorize it. But it become a part of you when you get on, you go to rehearsals. When you go to rehearsals and you're interacting with your other people in your play and you're speaking that, then that's when that part becomes alive for you. And it really becomes alive when it's just time for the production, when you have the dress rehearsal. The night before the big production, you dress out in what you're going to be on the stage in. And it's like, okay, this is it. You have to, and you go in, and that, you are really that part then. But it's a long process. It begins first with just reading a script, over and over, memorizing it, and then going to rehearsal over and over and over and over again. And then the production.
Mm-hmm. So the initial stage of it doesn't really produce the effect that takes place when you actually present the play, right?
No.
Okay. How do you get it into your heart? How do you get it into so that it becomes secondhand to you?
You got to visualize the part.
Okay,
I'm thinking of one I played in college. I was Queen Mary of Scotland. I had to really visualize being Queen Mary as I was reading that. And Queen Mary had to visualize, I'm Queen Mary when I'm on stage. I am Queen Mary, and I'm going to behave and act like Queen Mary. And the more I rehearsed it, the more I did it, the more the part became it became a part of me. So when the production time on stage, I was Queen Mary. You know, I was transformed into that part through just rehearsing and rehearsing and rehearsing. First, memorization. But memorization didn't do it. It came from just playing the part rehearsing over and over and over again. And then you internalize it. And when you internalize it, you're on the stage interacting with your other actors and actresses, then, you know, you become that person.
Now, how do you go about learning stuff, learning going along? Because sometimes you have 20 pages.
Well, I was young then. I had a good mind.
I can do all things through Christ.
Oh, well, I did have excellent memory. I just, when all the other kids were out having fun and, you know, doing whatever they did, I was in my room rehearsing.
Did you read it to yourself?
I read it to myself. I visualized it. I walked around the room with my script in my hand.
Said it out loud.
I said it out loud. I read paragraph by paragraph and went over it, closed my eyes, rehearsed it. And when I did all of this, you know, after a while, I had it. I had it, yeah.
Yeah, when you begin to get dull, you know, like a lot of us, you can go to a telephone book, you say, I'm going to look up this business number. You look it up, and before you dial it, you forgot it. Nobody like that in here. All right, well, try. It all depends on what you've been through, what you've been thinking about, given your mental state. Is that right? Okay. Now, suppose you said that out loud. 584-7200. You think you'll forget that?
No.
Not Harvey.
Well, they say you say it three times.
All right. If you say it three times,
well, that's
what somebody said.
That's what I heard.
So speaking things out does program things into your subconscious mind.
And you know something? I was in college. I graduated in 1963. I can still remember some of those lines I had. I can still remember now. This recall, I can still remember.
So why is it that many times we don't feel that we have to speak things out in order to get them into our spirit in the kingdom of God. I think that we talked about that a little bit last week. And I think that we came to the conclusion that many times people don't